Hello and the greetings from Iceland. But in this tour, we will visit the seismic zone in northern Iceland in order to cover the large earthquake that could occur there or up to magnitude 7. And I'm hoping that this video will be useful every now and then, since we do get seismic chapters that can go on for weeks up north. So when I do my news related updates, I will have this video link to share, so I won't have to repeat myself too often. So welcome to the north. The plate boundaries through Iceland are defined as the north and south seismic zones, and the midpoint is the Bárðarbunga hotspot under Vatnajökull glacier, and the north zone is just as spectacular as the south zone, so this will also be a sightseeing tour, since after all, everything you are about to see originated from the same plate boundaries that created Iceland with such a strange and diverse landscape. And today I will be following the rift zone from the Krafla volcano region up to this bay called Öxarfjörður and from there to the Tjörnes Fracture Zone. That's our epicenter today. And we don't have to go a long way back to find major events, since we had this rifting chapter between 1975 and 1984, where we got in total 9 eruptions, or a chapter that perhaps peaked with a magnitude 6.3 earthquake by a town called Kópasker. And that was the last large earthquake that occurred on the Tjörnes Fracture Zone. But before we move there, I have to mention the bigger picture, so I'm starting here by the volcano Krafla, where in total 29 eruptions took place since the settlement of Iceland. So this is a highly active region, but the other side of the coin is that there is also geothermal energy to be found under there, and during the early 80s, it was decided to build the first large geothermal power plant around here, or behind this explosion crater, where the land blew up in 1724. For a while, it looked as if the power plant would never get into operation, since during the construction period, seismic activity grew rapidly, and 9 eruptions took place north of the power plant, or here, where the fault ruptures can be seen all around, and they stretch all the way to the sea by the north coast. And the Krafla rifting episode turned out to be a textbook demonstration of tectonic plate movements that helped the global science community a lot to gather information about Earth's outer shell and its movements. But let's move to the Tjörnes Fracture Zone, further up north. And on our way there, we find yet another shield volcano, but it's actually hard to see its form clearly unless I'm shooting from the north, but from the Tjörnes Peninsula, it looks like this. And there is a new geothermal power plant by this volcano at a place called Þistareykir, and we see it here. And magma intrusions have been detected around there in the last decades, so the volcano isn't quite dead yet. And in front of it, to the north, we have the north coast, where a new lake came into being after the earthquake in 1976. So it did change the landscape a lot around here. And as I was prepping for this video, I felt so well how much video content can be found all around here for my channel. Many places worth covering, but that's for later. I'm gonna stick to the Tjörnes Fracture Zone now in this video, but it's tectonically complicated triangular area and mostly under sea, which limits, of course, historical and geological observations. And when even our finest experts can't explain it fully, I'm only scratching the surface when it comes to geology. But the earthquake map is more and less telling the whole story in regards to the transverse zones and how active it is. And the part of it that we should be worried about is a so-called Flatey Húsavík fault that we have here. It has literally flattened the town here, called Húsavík, 2 times. So now it's time to show you footage from my 2 recent trips to Húsavík. And the first aerial shots are since this spring, or from there the fault is very visible by the town. So I will be showing you both sides of it, first from this end, and then we move here. And we have the island Flatey in the background, and the fault runs through that island, under the town, and then across the complete Tjörnes Peninsula. And this is not a good location, so a workshop was held in Húsavík in 2019, where our best experts got together with the civil defense and many experts from abroad as well. And the workshop left us with a good report, so for those of us who want to dig deeper, you can use the link in the description box for the report, but it's in English. And it was two earthquakes that left the towns in ruins. First in 1755, but it was estimated to be of magnitude 7, or as big as they get in Iceland, or so I believed until just a few days ago. And that earthquake was the first one that left us with some usable historical information to work with. But a tsunami wave overturned two boats close by the harbor and killed several people. The mountains could not be seen due to dust clouds from the rock slides, and a huge wave battered the coastline that broke down in numerous places and destroyed the habitats of many seabirds. Many described unusual mist shortly after the largest earthquake, so an undersea eruption was suspected but never confirmed though, so it's no wonder why this bay is called Skjálfandaflói, which means the Shaking Bay. In 1872, this same fault was at work, and it's believed that two earthquakes struck that time at both ends of the fault. Our experts believe so from ancient stories. There are tales of fissures opening up on this cape where something like blue gas was streaming up for 4 days and such heat that you couldn't place your hand over the fissure and even flares coming up from it. The ocean retreated from the bay and then returned with the heavy waves that hit the shoreline, and overall the ancient stories describe this major event of unprecedented scale here in Iceland, and the town was left in ruins for the second time. So as I got back with this spring footage I was showing you of the fault, I started to browse through science reports to prepare for this video, and that's when I found out that I just missed the most important spot, and it was a report that was made for Alcoa that made me go back to get more footage. But they planned to build an aluminium smelter just north of Húsavík, so a geology report was of course needed, and experts dug some trenches across this fault. So now I'm swapping to summer footage from a second trip, where I will be covering this part of the coast. But this Alcoa report that made me go back indicated several faulting events, and the earthquakes in 1755 and 1872 seem to have left only minor disturbances in the soil, but older displacement was found by those cliffs, or a meter scale vertical offset less than 2500 years old, according to the tephra layers. And that came as a surprise. So I have to wonder, from my limited knowledge in geology, can this fault lead to even larger earthquakes than magnitude 7? Or how large was this earthquake that caused this major displacement? So the conclusion in that report was simple, or 4 words, obvious major seismic risk. And then, after 6 years of preparation, Alcoa in Iceland withdrew its plans to build an aluminium smelter there, but not for those reasons, at least officially. And then some of our politicians went nuts, especially the so-called Green Party. But its leader back then comes from this region, the Northeast region, and every vote is important. So the story gets only, well, I can't say better, but at least more interesting. And this is in a way a mini seminar in Icelandic politics, but this report from 2006 tells us that not only did we get 2 major earthquakes during historic times, but even a larger one, not so long ago, when we are into geology. So one of our finest professors in earth science stood up and wrote an article where he stated that we could most likely not find a worse place in Iceland for a metal smelter. And the irony continues, since this local green politician is actually a geologist himself. So what did he do with this knowledge? He made the taxpayers pay for those tunnels through this cape or from the fault in order to make easier access to the harbor from this new industrial area they were planning to sell with some perks to a foreign company, just some company that would give them a reason to make yet another power plant. And to make a long story short, it worked out for them. And this state-of-the-art silicon metal factory was built even closer to the fault than Alcoa had previously planned. So this is more or less telling me that geology reports are of no use. The experts can say whatever. It was only a formality to pay them to dig some trenches there. And even if they dig up some bad news, like they surely did, there is just this file cabinet somewhere where they can put that report to gather dust. So it's really not just Mother Nature that's being sarcastic around here. But the history of earthquakes around here goes on. In 1910, we got another magnitude 7 earthquake, but offshore this time, so it didn't cause so much damage, but it could be felt all over the country. Another earthquake struck on the so-called Dalvik alignment in 1934, and I did cover it in a recent video I'm linking to. And the last large earthquake was the 1976 Kópasker earthquake. But there are also indications about an undersea eruption 50 kilometers north of the island Grímsey, but a relatively new lava rock was found there in 2005, and only 2 years ago we got a strong earthquake swarm by the mouth of Eyjafjörður, luckily not triggering the Flatey-Húsavík fault, but things got tense for a while. And the Tjörnes Peninsula itself is a kind of university for geologists with fossil layers that are so interesting. They make it possible to trace changes in climate, vegetation and marine life from the beginning of the Ice Age. But there I'm into a subject that requires a video of its own. Like the tsunami risk, but major earthquakes in North Iceland are mostly strike slip events. The Húsavík Flatey fault is, however, not a pure strike slip fault everywhere. Large lateral strike slip movements might possibly trigger a tsunami, but submarine slumps have yet to be identified and mapped. And what our experts say in general is that there is enough tension in the region for up to magnitude 7 earthquake, and the report from the 2019 workshop did mention the possibility of an even larger earthquake as a rare but possible scenario, although I didn't see the Alcoa report mentioned there especially. So like sometimes before, I was a bit shocked after doing my own research. Not about the politics though, nothing new there. It's actually been working well for the community to have the silicon metal industry around, plenty of jobs, and it thrives well. But I do however think that it was a miserable idea to place it so close by this active fault. It simply goes against all common sense, and it's also an insult when it comes to the science community. So the bottom line has to be, if the reports from there were ignored, all future reports are just this useless formality when it comes to our building policy and planning. And I actually don't understand how our experts can tolerate this, especially in this extreme case. And even if we have seen the last of such major events that caused this meter scale vertical offset, a large earthquake up to magnitude 7 is what they expect. Perhaps not for the next decades, but surely it will strike someday. We might get lucky, we might get some strong warning signs first. The earthquake might not be as large as we can expect, but then we might also get unlucky, get a magnitude 7 causing landslides in a mountain above the town, even causing a tsunami and waves that can easily access the industrial area or the port of Húsavík, which is this very beautiful and a nice town. And if we would get unlucky, we would have to look back and ask what kind of idiots were in charge of planning decisions back then, while we had all the knowledge we needed to avoid this fault at all cost. And while making this video, I got the same feeling as I got last year, as I was covering how we have been moving our capital closer to the plate boundaries year by year. And are we in general too optimistic? It's a good question. Only time can tell, of course, but I strongly suspect that Húsavík is not the only planning mistake we are making now. But I will cover that later on in a video where I speak about the location of our capital or how prepared it is as we are moving into a chapter of unrest that might go on for the next 200 years on the Reykjanes Peninsula, just by our doorsteps. And I'm hoping to get that one online soon, but it required a lot of footage that I've been gathering little by little. And finally, I want to mention that you can support my work with the like button or with your subscription and the other ways that I'm mentioning in the video description. And with that, I'm sending you best regards from the earthquake and the volcano island, Iceland.